I know, 20 minutes. Can you all sit for another 20 minutes before you have tea or lunch or...
Yes,
of course you can. Of course you can. You're resilient. I just need a clicker, please. Can we have my presentation on the screen? There we go. Namaste. I'm super, super excited to be here today. And part of the reason why I'm here is because I love working with people, teams and organizations to create next level performers who will succeed in the challenging and changing marketplace. And I say next level performers because it doesn't matter where you are in your business, in your sports, in your life, in your mountain, whether you're in a valley, base camp, camp one, two, three, on a plateau or at the summit, if you're prepared to learn and apply new skills, behaviors and mindset, you can go to the next level. I'm originally from the UK. I'm married to Americans, stepdaughters in New Zealand, and having led 58 expeditions around the globe, I've got friends absolutely everywhere, and I have very dear friends from Nepal. And I call them actually my family, and some of them are in the audience, Bibu over there with his dear wife. So thank you, Taniba, Nepal. I live in Abu Dhabi. Anybody else in the room from the UAE, from Abu Dhabi? Yes, yes, some dear friends over there, executive women, Sue, Jad, Sylvie, Shireen, awesome, fantastic. I've got some raving fans over there. So I've lived in the Middle East and Asia, Hong Kong, Dubai, Abu Dhabi predominantly for 20 years. And for 14 of these years, I've been coming to Nepal. So I have a very long history with Nepal. And you'll see some pictures later on in the presentation to show that. I climbed my first mountain when I was 40, not so long ago, kind of 15 years actually. And at the summit of that mountain, Kota Kinabalu in Malaysia, I had this epiphany. I'm on a mountain, I'm on a natural high. Mountain High, that would be a really cool name for an expedition company. But I didn't have the courage and the confidence to start that until a whole year later when I brought a team of 18 women to Everest Base Camp. 18 women, 18 days, 18,000 feet, and we raised $80,000 towards a mobile breast screening unit in Al Ain. And so it was really, woo! It was after that trip that I finally had the courage and the confidence to start Mountain High. So a big, big dhanyawad to Nepal for giving me that space, time, freedom in the mountains to actually think about what I really, really wanted to do. And of course, the other big reason why I love Nepal is because it's where I got engaged at the summit of Island Peak back in 2008. My then boyfriend, very resilient, knew that a lunch and a bottle of champagne wouldn't work it for me, and we had to go and climb a mountain. So that's at the summit of Island Peak. So what are we going to be talking about today over the next 15, 20 minutes? Is resilience. And resilience is basically an essential skill, whether you're climbing a mountain, writing a book, running a business, in a hospital ward, fighting for your life. It is essential to success. And this is something that is a skill we can learn. And it starts at a really, really early age. Just remember when you were first learning to walk, how many times you actually fell down? Hundreds, maybe thousands of times, and parents were saying, come on, come on, you can do this. They didn't say after five times, oh, forget it, you're obviously not very good at this, because if they had, we'd still be crawling around on the floor. So it begins at a very early age. How many people in the room have been heartbroken? Financially embarrassed? Turned down for a job? My gosh. You've all had a very lovely life. Lost a loved one. Been blown up a mountain. Had a no summit climb. And these are all experiences. And for every experience you have, you learn a lesson, whether you feel that experience was good or bad. And the more experiences you have, the more resilient you are. And the more resilient you are, the more able you're to cope with changes, with fast changes, and bounce back. So there's a few definitions of resilience up there. I'm not going to read through them because I know we're really short on time. But the one I really love is at the bottom, and it's a quote by Lao Tzu. I can't claim it's my quote. Stand like mountain, flow like water. And there are times in our life when we do need to stand strong, like a mountain when there's storms going on around us. And then there's times when we need to let go and go with the flow, like the rivers, the boat cozy, the sun cozy, the Trisuli River, they just go with the flow and they weave around obstacles. So these are the definitions of resilience. And a couple of my own, cowgirl up, do you like the cowboy boots from Steamboat Springs, Colorado? Cowgirl up is an expression my late mother-in-law, Alice Miles Lewis, taught me. Whenever you had any challenges, you'd share them with her. She would never give you the answer. She'd look at you in the eye and say, cowgirl up, or cowboy up if you were male. And if you fall off your horse, if you fail, have a setback, a disappointment, you get back up, you dust yourself down, and you get back on that horse and you ride. How many people have fallen off a bike learning how to cycle? Good, I'm glad there's some more people in this room that have had some experience. Are you very shy? And the other one, the sumo wrestler. Sumo. Step up. Move on. Or for a little bit harsher, shut up. Move on. Because it's very easy to say stuck and blame and complain and justify and give everybody else a hard time instead of taking responsibility. So a couple of my own two favorites. So 21st century life, if there's one word that you could describe 21st century life, I think it would be fast. So much information, information overload. I talk about mental obesity, media, tweets, everything, information overload. What we did yesterday, what we're doing tonight, what are we doing tomorrow? There's information overload, and it's very easy to burn out. What do you do when your phones run out of battery? Plug it in. What about your car when it runs out of fuel? Go to the station and fill it up. But what about when you are running low? Drink more coffee, think I've got to get this done, but we've got to keep moving. So the 21st century life is fast and furious, which is why we need time out. You need to come to Nepal more often, this is what I'm basically saying. So resilience. We said the five essential skills for peak performance and productivity. I studied in the UK with the top business psychologist on resilience, Nicholson McBride. And they've been studying resilience since 2009, created 35,500 reports. They had a resilience team of high-end CEOs, athletes, people in high-stress jobs, accident, emergency, etc. And they came up with five essential traits for resilience. And no, this doesn't work for getting the little dot on it. So optimism, solution orientation, individual accountability, managing your stress, openness and flexibility. So those are the five skills that we're going to flick through in the next 15 minutes, 12 minutes, let's see. Okay, so optimism, this is the essential skill and it impacts all of the others. And this is the ability to look at things, the possibilities of what's possible, to be an optimist instead of a pessimist. And I love the quote from the best Marigold Hotel, everything will be all right in the end. And if it's not all right, it's not the end. I just love that. So it's being smiling and looking at possibilities, not thinking about all the things that could go wrong. Lovely smiling faces. The one far right is a lovely monk that we met in Bhutan last year at 4,000 meters. And he said, you know, if you want to be happy, be. And that's really about being present and grounded like a mountain. The second skill is solution orientation. I live in Abu Dhabi. Lots of sand, lots of desert. Nothing like coming to the Himalayas or to the Arctic and Antarctica. So what do you do when you're training for something like that? You think of the solution And the solution is Ski Dubai. Everybody been to Ski Dubai?
Yeah.
Yes?
Yes.
An indoor ski slope in a shopping mall. Can you believe it? So thinking about solution orientation, instead of looking at the situation and discussing the situation, change it to an outcome discussion. What else? What else? What can we do? And that was the solution. And often in business, we don't do things because we think, well, we haven't got it. We can't start. But think of what you can do to get started. The next skill is individual accountability. And the introducer mentioned that 14 years ago, I came to Nepal for the first time with 18 women. And we stayed actually here at this hotel, so it's quite nostalgic when I walked in because I had all these memories flowing back from that first trip. Accountability, doing what you say you're going to do, being impeccable with your word. All of these women signed up for a trip and I said, you need to be now accountable to train, to think, eat, move and sleep like an Everest base camp woman. And we had accountability partners call up, hey, how's your training going? This is so important, to be accountable to yourself, to others, to the organization, to the community in which you work. To build trust and to keep those solid agreements and be responsible, responsible to commit, because your accountability impacts the team and the organization's accountability. Openness and flexibility. And this is so, so key. And I showed a picture here taken up in the Solo Kumba region, because when you're out in vast open spaces, there's nowhere to run and there's nowhere to hide. You have to be open, you have to bare yourself to Mother Nature. And in business, sometimes we hide things, we're not open, we don't tell the truth. And it's really about being very open. And I loved Alan's story yesterday about telling the truth. And sometimes people don't want to hear that. They want to know the dramas, the fantastic, you know, the myths and the legends. And it's actually being open and honest and being truthful. The other aspect is being flexible. Can anybody do that move? Any yogis in the room? Kind of. I'm not going to do it because I've got a skirt on. And no flashing in Nepal. So being flexible. There's many, many paths up a mountain, not just one route. And the more opportunities and flexibility you have, the more success you will have. If it was only one route and you can't get that route, then you're not going to get there. So openness and flexibility. The fifth essential skill is managing stress and anxiety. 80% of the reason why people go to the doctors, you loop it back and it's linked into stress. And I'm a great believer that a lot of the stress now is due to our disconnection from nature. We're uber connected to our phones, our iPads, but we're not really connecting to nature on a more regular basis, or to people. People can do this, but they can't shake a hand and look at somebody in the eye and have those social interactions. So things like being out in nature, and what I call your nature quotient. How much time do you spend in nature? Because spending time in an air-conditioned office under fluorescent lighting, looking at an iPad for 6 to 8 hours is not natural to me. Does everybody agree? Good, I'm glad there's some NQers in the audience. So managing stress, identifying your stresses, and then neutralizing, time out in nature, going for a walk, having a good laugh, playing with your kids. It's really, the more relaxed you are, the better decisions you make. The higher you climb up the mountain, the harder it becomes. It's tough to get to the top and it's tough to stay at the top in business. So the more relaxed, energized you are, more calm and focused, the more likely you are to succeed. Asking for help. David, you came up with this. And really, this is so, so important. And the people that ask for help are the people that are the most successful. So I highly recommend, if you have an ego, let it go and be willing to ask for help. Because asking for help is a sign of strength, not of weakness. and that reaching out for a helping hand. There's a lovely quote, it's an African proverb: if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go further, go together. And Kofi Annan spoke that words at the Global World Forum. It's so, so powerful. There's one of us compared to all of us, and all of us are so much smarter than one of us. So never, ever be afraid to ask for help. Nepal needs you. This has got nothing to do with resilience. This is why we are all here, why we've been invited and hosted and flown in from around the globe. Because Nepal needs help. And the best way you can help Nepal is by supporting tourism. And that's easy. And people come from all around the world. Not just once, not just twice. Season round. Because we do have the world in our hands. Where we live in Abu Dhabi, Dubai, it takes 4 hours to get here. So you don't necessarily have to make a big trip. You could just come for the weekend. And I really, really love this country. And I just think the best way that we can support Nepal is to bring tourism to Nepal. Bring tourism to Nepal. Tell all of our friends through social media. And really realize that asking for help is a sign of strength. And we can help. There's so much we can do through tourism, through supporting projects. And my last bit of advice, because I think I might be running. I'm done. Give me one more minute. It's from an incredible friend I met in Antarctica, Perky the penguin. And what I say to you, regardless of what's going on in your life, on in your business, on in your country, rather than getting all hot and bothered and flustered and running around, is to open your arms to possibility, run towards your fears. You see, that's pretty good, balance, hey? And be happy and stay cool. Is that good advice to finish on? Would everybody like to stand up and be perky? Come on, stand up, let me show you. That, I love it. Somebody get a picture of all these resilient people in the audience. Give yourself a round of applause. Thank you very, very much.